Now that we've seen some sorts of information that we can store in a database table, let's talk about how our code talks to a database. When our code fetches data out of a database, it does this by sending a query. In response, the database will send us a result containing a new table with the data that we asked for. Depending on the specifics of our environment, our code might be talking to the database over the network, or it might just be calling a library that keeps a database on local disk. Those design details will be important later, but for now we can actually ignore them. The basics of databases work the same no matter what the implementation is. So let's take a look at running some queries in SQL against an actual database. Don't worry about the syntax right now. We'll see that in the next lesson. Okay, so here's a query we saw before. Select food from diet where species equals orangutan. And when we run it, here's the result. Now something to notice about the result is that it's a table. It has two rows, even says two rows down underneath the table, and it has one column, the food column that we asked for. So running a query against a database isn't like returning a single value from a function. It's more like returning a list, even if there might only be one element. In fact, even if we ask the database for 2 + 2, like this, the answer is still actually a table with one column and one row. If we ask the database for the answers to 3 arithmetic problems at once, then we'll get back a table with a single row and 3 columns, each one of them giving one of the answers. You might have noticed that these columns have rather unusual names. They all are question mark, column, question mark. If we want to give them more descriptive names, we can do that. By using as sum here, we get back still a table, still with one row and one column, but now the column has a more descriptive name of sum instead of question mark, column, question mark.